abnormal capnographic waveform morphology can be used to identify a number of different pathologies and conditions. We'll go through each of these. Successful intubation. First, we'll talk about what a normal capnograph can tell us. Capnography has become the gold standard method for confirmation of intubation. Once a patient has been successfully intubated, a normal or nearly normal graph can be used to confirm intubation. A patient with inadequate ventilation or apnea prior to intubation should be expected to have a high end tidal CO2 at first, but adequate ventilation ought to correct this. Characteristics of a normal capnograph include an end tidal CO2 between 35 and 45 millimeters of mercury. The alpha and beta angles should both be well defined, and the rhythm should be regular. Loss of waveform. The opposite of the successful intubation is, of course, the accidental extubation. Sudden loss of the waveform can indicate extubation. Loss of waveform, or really any sort of problem following intubation, should trigger the practitioner to consider the dope mnemonic. Displacement or dislodgement of the ET tube is one possibility, but obstruction of the tube with blood or mucus should be considered. Pneumothorax should be routinely considered as part of the mnemonic. And equipment failure could take the form of an interrupted ventilator circuit or just a kinked or blocked capnographic sample tubing. Decreasing end tidal CO2. Decreasing end tidal CO2 is usually the result of hyperventilation. Sometimes this is the result of an intentional choice to normalize the CO2 in a hypercapnic patient, and sometimes it indicates the need to modify the ventilation parameters to maintain the normal CO2. Hypothermia and decreased metabolism can also cause decreasing CO2. Increasing end tidal CO2 is usually the result of hypoventilation, and again, this may be the result of an intentional choice by the healthcare practitioner. Unintentional hypoventilation should be corrected by adjusting the ventilation parameters. Increasing core temperature and increasing metabolism may also lead to an increasing end tidal CO2. Another consideration is an anomalous rise in the circulation of metabolic waste resulting from either rhabdomyolysis or reperfusion of an underperfused tissue, as you might expect to see in a crush injury or suspension trauma. Escalating baseline. An escalating baseline is occasionally seen in the mechanically ventilated patient. This usually results from partially rebreathing exhaled air, and it usually indicates an incompetent inspiratory or expiratory valve. It may also be the result of insufficient expiratory time or insufficient inspiratory flow. Obstructive disorders. This waveform is characterized by the loss of definition in the alpha angle. This is often referred to as the sharkfin waveform, and it's indicative of something obstructing exhalation. Most often this is the result of bronchospasm or COPD, and should be considered diagnostic evidence if it fits the clinical presentation. Cardiac arrest and ROSC. Capnography serves a couple of useful purposes in the setting of cardiac arrest. The partial pressure of CO2 can be used to effectively judge the efficacy of chest compressions. Generally, an end tidal CO2 of greater than 10 millimeters of mercury indicates that chest compressions are effective, while one below 10 millimeters of mercury indicates poor compressions and or a poor prognosis. The return of spontaneous circulation, or ROSC, is also evident on the graph in the form of an abrupt increase in the expired CO2 to a value in excess of roughly 35 millimeters of mercury. Karari cleft. The Karari cleft is seen in the phase 3 alveolar plateau. When a patient is being ventilated and attempts a spontaneous breath during the exhalation phase, it is seen as a slight, momentary reduction in the measured CO2. The Karari cleft may be interpreted as fair warning that sedation is insufficient or that the paralytics have worn off.